Hi, I'm Scotty. I service, repair and restore vintage and antique mechanical clocks. Welcome to Scotties Clock World.
This is the next in our series about clock parts and how they work. This is an escape wheel. You can see the teeth are a different shape on the escape wheel, and we'll discuss that in a minute. To a normal clock wheel, quite different. First up, we'll answer the question, what is an escapement? An escapement is a mechanical linkage in mechanical clocks that gives impulses to the timekeeping element and periodically releases the gear train to move forward and allows the clock hands to advance. As this rotates, these are the pallets that run back and forwards there through a pin in the center located there, and it allows one tooth to escape at a time and regulates the speed of the clock. The impulse action transfers energy from the clock's timekeeping element, which is usually a pendulum bob, we have one there, and it replaces the energy lost to friction during its cycle, and to keep the timekeeper oscillating, this has to continue to turn as the pallets run backwards and forwards on it. If this stops, the clock stops. The escapement is driven by the force, here we go, of the coil spring, as we saw in the last video, and is transmitted through the timepiece's gear train. We've seen the gear train, the going train, and the strike train as we had them laid out before. Each swing of the pendulum, backwards and forwards, releases a tooth on the escape wheel, allowing the clock's gear train to advance by a fixed amount. It goes one tooth at a time, catches there, and runs back and forwards. This regular periodic advancement moves the clock's hands forward at a steady and constant rate once the movement is in beat. If it's not in beat, then it's not going to happen. The same time, the tooth here gives the clock movement a push, and another tooth catches on the escapement's pallet. As that one comes out, that one goes in and stops there. And after the impulse that comes out, the wheel rotates the next tooth. It's caught there by that pallet. A bit out of proportion here while I'm holding it, but it's caught like that. And then an impulse, and it goes again, and that back part of the pallet, the back pallet there, catches on that wheel there. And that's sort of basically what it is, and that just keeps turning on it as we've seen before. Now that's why the teeth are very different shape here, because as opposed to normal teeth, which run square like so, this wheel turns and turns that wheel there, but they're all square cut, and they fit in there, back over there, that one goes there, and they mesh up and run around like so. But not so the escape wheel, because the pallets have to catch when it's in the center there. Go that way, it catches a wheel there, that pallet is exposed, the impulse pushes it back that way, this wheel on this side, this tooth on this side of the pallet is released, and the next tooth coming up on that side is blocked by the pallet. And then it rolls back again, back and forth, and the wheel very slowly turns around like that. and that clicking and clacking in and out of the teeth there by the pallet is what generates the classic ticking sound on a clock. It goes tick tock, tick tock, tick tock as the teeth catch on the pallet. Right, goes there. Now the other part that goes along with this, these are the pallets that react with the escape wheel. This is called the crutch. This is a pendulum rod, including bent suspension spring at the top. We'll have to straighten that before we put it back in. And a suspension rod is attached to the movement like so and sits down through the bottom of the crutch. And as the pendulum swings left and right, can't see it there, it's out of whack. As the pendulum swings left and right, the pallets move backwards and forwards. And that's what keeps time on the clock once the movement is in beat. If it's not in beat, then the beat becomes very irregular and it will eventually stop sooner or later if the clock's not in beat. It's important that the pivots, as with all the wheels, that one there and that one there, have been smoothed off, usually with 2000 grit emery paper on a popsicle stick, one of those, written on the back, 2000 mesh. It's normally bent in the center like so, and you put the pivot in between the two pieces of mesh, hold it over the top with your finger, and then spin the wheel backwards and forwards, which removes any highlights on the pivot. Like so. You do the same with the other end. Hold it tightly so it doesn't drop out. And then rotate the wheel and it smooths the pivot. This is normally done prior to rebushing. And that's the escape wheel. It always sits right at the top of the movement, and quite often on American clocks this is how you will see it. So get that pivot into the bush. Maybe, yes, no. There it is there, like so. It has this little bit of wire here. When you put the pallets on, strange angle trying to put it on there. That's properly positioned. That bit of bent wire goes over the top, rests on the top of the post like so, which then allows the pallets to move backwards and forwards without falling off. Move that, take the pallet off. carefully take the escape wheel out again. Put that down there.
If you enjoyed this video and want to learn more about antique and vintage clock repair, be sure to hit the subscribe button before watching these next two videos.